Welcome to the Bible Study Hour. We are truly appreciative of the fact that you have chosen to take this special time out of all of what you have to pay attention to and to stay with us so that we can go through this Bible Study Hour together. Whether you are with us on WCCN or Facebook or YouTube, we want to say a special welcome. Whether you're with us every week from years beyond or you are joining us for the first time, we are giving you a special welcome this week. And we just want to remind you that the lessons that we are going through for this quarter are lessons that are all based on the whole matter of God's everlasting covenant. And because we are included in the covenant, believe it or not, we are, it is so important that you really pay attention to it and see how God has made provision for all of us, to save all of us. We are really happy that we can join you this week. And we are happy that I am not here alone. I am here with two of our regular participants. You might see one more than the other, but they are still with us because on my right this week, we have director Carol Smythe James. You might have missed her a few weeks, but she's still with us, and we are happy to have her this week. And on my left, we have Pastor James Sunlin. We're getting to know him more and more because he's ever here with us. And they join in with me, Lorna Stevenson, as we share in this discussion together. And we are happy to know that you are joining in with us as well. We pause here to say thanks to our sponsors, Easy Deal Auto Sales and Tours Limited, located at 1139 Catherine Hall, Montego Bay. Get them on the telephone, if you will, at 876-371-2804. We know that in the whole process of preparing to discuss this lesson with you, we have to give thanks to all persons who have participated in making this a reality. But as always, we give special thanks to God because it is God who has directed us. It is God who has made the provision for us to do this for you. And it's all about God that we are studying. So as we pay homage to God and His Word, we pause now to invite Him to direct our deliberations and ask you to join us in prayer.
Our Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the opportunity to study your words. We seek now to understand more about the everlasting covenant written in your words. We pray that your Holy Spirit will guide our minds and that you will guide the minds of our viewers, that all of us will experience your blessings. In Jesus' name,
amen. Amen. I'm sure that you would have noticed by now that much of our studies and our references come from the book of Genesis. Of course, we have other, you know, references too, but it's kind of a focusing on a lot of happenings and because it's the beginning, God establishing his covenant with mankind. And this week, as we talk about an everlasting covenant, we are looking at a memory text which comes to us from Genesis chapter 17, verse 7. And we read together, it says, I, God, will establish my covenant between me and you, Abraham, and your descendants after you throughout their generations, for an everlasting covenant to be God to you and to your descendants after you. God is here establishing not only a covenant, but establishing himself.
Yes.
Because he makes it very clear what's going on here as we look at the memory text a little closer. Start us off, Pastor Sunlin, by giving us some kind of amplification on what is here in our text.
Well, we know that God has called Abram from the Ur of the Chaldees, and God told him all the various plans that he had for him, mm-hmm, and for his generations. And God is making a commitment that he's going to be his God. He's going to be there for him. He's going to bless him. And this is a commitment God is making. God is really saying to Abraham, it's not that I have to depend on you, but I am telling you what I am willing to do. I'm demonstrating my love, my care, my concern for you. And therefore, I am making a commitment that I am going to be your God. And I want to establish not just a covenant, but a relationship.
Yes.
A close relationship with you and your generations, because I want you to be a blessing to all people. And that's really God's plan for Abraham and his people.
Yes.
Okay. When you look at the word covenant, we see that a covenant is a contract between two parties. And here we see that it is between God and humanity, what God is going to do. So God was talking to Abraham, saying, hey, I'm going to establish it. So God was the one who we see here talking with Abraham. This is what I'm going to do. You know, and this is not going to be forever, everlasting. When we look at everlasting, it's a word forever and ever and ever. So he's saying, listen to me, I'm going to make it between you. Yes, it's between me and you. It's going to be between your descendants, and it's going to keep on going and going. And this is to let us know that we know that God, when he said he's going to do anything, he's going to do it.
Mm-hmm.
So he is a promise keeper. So it's just for us to do keep our side of the bargain.
All right. So two of the points that you have cleared up or you have commented on in this memory text, two of these points are, one, that this covenant that God is setting up is an everlasting covenant. It's going to last for all times.
Yes.
And also that in this statement that God has made, mm-hmm. he has said that he is going to be God to Abraham and to his generations forever.
That's right.
So that relationship mm-hmm. is there right. for us to hold on to. Yeah,
definitely.
There's no need for us to say, well, time up now. Because God wants to be our God mm-hmm. forever and ever. In fact, he is our God forever and
forever.
Ever. It's
forever.
Only that maybe we might choose
not to
be.
Right.
All right.
Well, I like the statement that is in the introduction that says the Lord was not going to leave his world unattended.
That's right.
Not with it in such dire need.
Mm-hmm.
Right. You know, and we have to look at the background, what we studied before.
That's right.
That the world was in trouble because of sin. And God called Noah to let him know that because he trusted him mm-hmm. as God, mm-hmm. he's willing to deliver him out of it.
Mm-hmm.
And this is what God is saying. Adam mess up.
Mm-hmm.
Adam's generation are still getting in mess.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm not going to leave them. Like, I'm going to be there.
I made that move to correct the situation.
Yes. Yes.
But look, mankind just mess up again.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
And he's so determined
yes.
not to leave
us on our own.
That's right.
And what a God he is, because he's constantly running after us. It's just for us to respond, to stop what we are doing and just hear what he has to say to us.
That's right.
Right. This section of our lesson for this week talks about names. In fact, it's not just this section, but a great part of the discussion talks about names. Mm-hmm. And in this first section, we are looking at the name Yahweh. Yahweh and the Abrahamic covenant. So we are going to take two verses to look at as we discuss this. Genesis chapter 15, verse 7, and that will be followed by Exodus chapter 3, verse 14.
And he said unto him, I am the Lord that brought thee out of Ur of the Chaldees to give thee this land to inherit it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, Exodus 3, 14.
Yes.
And God said unto Moses, I am that I am. And he said, thus said thou say unto the children of Israel, I am hath sent me unto you.
Good. Now we have a caption here which talks about Yahweh. Mm-hmm. And you just read a verse there that talks about I am.
Yeah.
I'm going to give Pastor Sunlin a difficult task to do. I think it might be difficult, but I don't think he thinks it's difficult. And that is to link these two names, Yahweh and I am.
First of all, we need to remember that the Bible was not written in English.
That's right.
It was written in Hebrew, Old Good Testament, start. And part Aramaic, and the New Testament in Greek. Mm-hmm. So what we're reading here, mm-hmm. and we see in the scripture, the word Lord, mm-hmm. capital L-O-R-D, mm-hmm. is really a translation of the word Yahweh. And of course, that name that God revealed himself is very difficult to pronounce, because the truth is there is no vowel in the Hebrew language.
Okay.
So what was written was Y-H-W-H. Mm-hmm. And the Hebrews thought that the name of God was too holy
to even call. Yes.
And so they use other names that would suggest a closer kind of relationship to them than the God who is mm-hmm. so high, so holy. Mm-hmm. And so Yahweh is the word that is used there in the Hebrew, and Yahweh really is talking about the ever eternal one.
Yes.
You know, the one who is forever. He's present always, everywhere. And the I am, he says in Exodus chapter 3:14, he's saying, I am not the past.
I have no past.
Not the future. I am always in the present. Mm. Yeah. He's eternal and he's ever present. Mm-hmm. And that's the kind of character he's revealing, that he's always the same God.
Yes.
As you look at this with Yahweh, I realize that there are many persons, even today in our dispensation, hang up on the name Yahweh. If you mm-hmm. don't call God that name, you're not calling
God.
You're not for real. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
But we realize that, yes, Yahweh is one of his name. And when we call that name, it's like to the highest. And calling it that I am. You know what I like about it? God is saying, I am that I am. You know, and even by just reading it and reflecting on it, when mm-hmm. they say I am, that means the I am, whatever situation that we are in, God is there. Whether you need money, you need this, you need that, whatever it is, he's saying, I am, I'll deliver you. And if as you look at even, as Zilles said, of how many times it has appeared in the Old Testament, 6,828 times, as we will not see the word Yahweh there, as Pastor said, but we'll see the word Lord in capital letter. This is to show us that God is right through the Old Testament. And you know, also too, many persons will say that the Old Testament is done away with. So if we are saying it's done away with, we are saying God is done away with in the Old Testament, which we know is not true. God is from the Old Testament to the New Testament, and the entire, you know, promise, as we look at it, covenant, is from Genesis to Revelation.
Well, the Old Testament and the New Testament find themselves right in the middle of time.
That's right.
And God was before time.
Yes.
That's
so
right. That's right.
There's no way you can cut off God from anywhere.
That's right.
Because he is. Is the existent one.
That's right.
And there is no sort of a putting him into any sort of a
box.
Well, not just a box, but any time frame.
Oh, that's right.
Because he is from everlasting to everlasting. Mm-hmm. Beyond the comprehension of man, of human beings.
As we look also, we see that the personal name that God used, Yahweh and other names, it is a revelation of his identity. Because don't forget that in the ancient times, the pagans worshiped many gods.
Yes.
And they all had their various names for their gods. Mm-hmm. And so they would have used other names that also refer to Lord.
All right.
Yep.
Hold it there, Pastor. because I'm going to get you to continue with that thought, but it's a nice way for us to just cut across and link up with El Shaddai.
Yes.
Yes. Another term that is used there as we talk about God, and we are going to go to Genesis chapter 17, verses 1 to 6.
Now read. And when Abram was 90 years old and nine, the Lord appeared to Abram and said unto him, I am the Almighty God. Walk before me and be thou perfect. And I will make my covenant between me and thee, and will multiply thee exceedingly. And Abram fell on his face, and God talked with him, saying, As for me, behold, my covenant is with thee, and thou shalt be a father of many nations. Neither shall thy name any more be called Abram, but thy name shall be Abraham, for a father of many nations have I made thee, and I will make thee exceeding fruitful, and I will make nations of thee, and kings shall come out of thee. And I will establish my covenant between me and thee, and thy seed after thee in their generations, for an everlasting covenant, to be a God unto thee, and to thy seed after thee.
Okay, as we read through that passage, we pause a little longer than normal at verse 1. And we see in verse 1 something that links with the name El Shaddai. How are we seeing God there? Remember the thought you were on before, Pastor?
Yes.
About the many names and God making himself, you know, known more and more in character. Pick it up for me, please.
God is revealing his identity, his character, who he is. And God is making himself known because humanity really don't understand God and will never completely understand God. And so God is choosing to reveal himself because he wants to have a relationship. And the best way to have a relationship is to reveal who you are. To develop that kind of relationship. And so in the first instance, God said, I am Yahweh. I am who I am. I am the ever-present God. But now in the second instance, God is introducing himself as the Almighty God. The all-powerful God. And why would God be doing this? God is revealing to Abraham that, look, there are things that you might be wondering how they are going to be done, how your generation is going to be multiplying when you don't have any offspring of your own. I am powerful enough to do that. And so I want you to understand that I'm not only the ever-present God, but I am also the powerful God who can do great things.
All right, good.
Okay, so when you look here, as you said, the El Shaddai, which is, as you said, two words, which El is God, and the Shaddai, which is Almighty. So when we put them together, as far as I'm saying, God Almighty. And we see God did not leave us by chance to guess. He just even it came out in verse 1 that he's a God Almighty. And when he was talking to Abraham, he said that he should walk before him perfect. You know, he should be perfect. And walking before God, perfect. We live up to the standard. Even for us, we need to be perfect before God. Live up to the standard that God has placed. So if God said we should not do this, we should not do it. So every step of the way, just as God has spoken to Abraham, God is speaking to us too.
Yes.
That he wants us to live that perfect life every day. So he's the God who is there with Abraham. And if what I like to, when you look at it, there many persons, even though we look at what is in a name, we know that there's power in a name. Nowadays, we find people give their children any kind of name. But we see here when God is called by name, it was a purpose. The ancient people, they have a name, as we say, Yahweh, the Lord, El Shaddai, God Almighty. And if we keep on going to say every situation, we could give God a name. So we too, we have our names. We need to live up to our names. It's special.
And as you talk about names and meaning of names and so on, when we come back, we are going to continue to talk about names and meanings and all that, because right now we are going to take a short break, but stay just where you are. We'll be back with you soon.
Bleeding in the darkness, the cell was cold and black. Driven to unconsciousness by the stripes upon his back, he heard a voice called out his name. His mind began to clear. In the darkness he replied, "Silas, I am here." Oh, my brother Silas, Paul, Otto with groans. Today when they were beating us, I thought we were going home. And when I opened up my eyes, I was gonna look upon Jesus' face. Now here we are together in this dreadful place. But I will praise the Lord. I will praise the Lord. No matter what tomorrow brings, what it has in store, I will praise the Lord. Of my life, I will praise his name. No matter what tomorrow brings, what it has in store, I will praise my God. This may be prison, and these may be chains. Still I'm free, to praise his name. In tribulations, how my heart will sing, 'cause he's the Messiah. Yes, he is the King of Kings. Some prisoners started waking up, singing fill the ear. Some men started swearing, then others were in tears. But suddenly it arose, there was no mistake, as Paul and Silas did praise the Lord, the walls began to shake. But I will praise the Lord all the days of my life. I will praise his name. So no matter what tomorrow brings and what it has in store, I will praise the Lord. Store, I will praise. of my life. All the days of my life I'm gonna praise Him. No, no, what it has in store.
Welcome back to the Bible Study Hour. We are so glad that you have stayed with us. We thank you so much. And we want to let you know that we are in the middle of discussing an everlasting covenant. We have been talking about names that are attached to God. And we are going to be talking some more about names, not necessarily attached to God now, but we can see in our discussion the importance of names. We're looking at the subtopic in our discussion at this time that talks about from Abram to Abraham. And because we are accustomed to this Bible character so much, sometimes we forget that he was even called Abram.
Yeah.
Because we know him as Father Abraham. Mm-hmm. All right. But there was a time when he was Abram. And Genesis chapter 17 speaks to the whole matter of the change of name. And there must have been a reason for this change of name. So we will read these two verses again from Genesis chapter 17. We are going to be reading verses 4 and 5 so we can get the link there.
It says here, as for me, behold, my covenant is with thee, and thou shalt be my be a father of many nations. Neither shall thy name any more be called Abram, but thy name shall be Abraham, for a father of many nations have I made thee.
Right. Both verse 4 and verse 5 make mention of the matter of father of many nations. So are we seeing here that the change of name was attached to this idea as we consider meanings of names?
Sure. I refer a little bit to what God said to Abraham.
Yes.
That he is the Almighty God,
mm-hmm.
El Shaddai.
Mm-hmm.
Don't forget that it is 24 years since the promise was made.
Wow. Come to think of it.
Yeah, a lot of years.
Yeah, because when he was leaving his home, he was 75.
75 years old.
That's right.
Now he's 99 years old.
Yes.
He's an old man. His wife is old and she has not yet produced a child, but God is giving him the message,
mm-hmm.
you are going to be the father of many nations.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Abraham no doubt would have been wondering, you know, Lord, is this going to happen again?
Yeah.
I mean,
is this for real?
The time is past. As a matter of fact, chapter 15,
mm-hmm.
God said, God, you have not given me any children and you have made a promise to me. And this is, I have an heir born in my house. I have none. What is going on? You know, so in chapter 17, when God introduced himself as El Shaddai, God was saying, Abram, don't you worry. have it all sorted out. I'm going to make it a reality.
Mm-hmm.
In chapter 18, Sarah laughed when the angels visited.
Yes.
You know, but God is saying, I'm going to let this happen. So now, you know what? I'm changing your name to remind you.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. From Abram, yeah. which is father, which means father is exalted,
mm-hmm.
to Abraham, the father of multitudes. I want to reassure you that this is what is going to happen. And so God is really putting it to him. It's going to be, I'm powerful enough, I'm changing your name to remind you of who you are, a mm-hmm. father of multitudes. And that's the message he
wants. So Pastor, what you're saying there is that the name Abraham has within it the promise that God made to the man,
exactly.
saying that I will make you a father of many nations.
Of course. Of
yes.
course. Of course.
That's interesting.
So he was giving him a name with a message.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah. And I think before we took the break, as yes. I was talking mm-hmm. about names.
Yes.
It's really interesting, though, to know that names are important, as I was saying. So we and I want to talk to parents, so be careful as of the names that you choose to give to your children, because sometimes they live out the names. But here we see that God has changed Abraham's name, and that is by faith for Abraham to believe,
mm-hmm.
because here it was, you're going to, in your old age, you're going to be a father of many nations, of multitudes. And this is to let us know that when God has made a promise, we just need to take him at his word.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes we cannot understand it, we cannot trace it, but we have to just believe yeah. that he's going to come through. And at times it's difficult, you know, because
yes.
when you look at it, me, I'm going to have a child, I can't believe it. But we see that the situation, we, as Pastor, I've mentioned, and we read in the Bible of all the things that went through between there, mm-hmm. of what Abraham and Sarah, they have done. But even the name changes, we have seen so many of them in the Bible had name changes. We have seen Jacob.
All right, since you're going there, let's go to the passage of scripture, which is Genesis chapter 32, verse 28.
The Bible says, and he said, thy name shall be called no more Jacob, but Israel, for as a prince hast thou power with God and with men, and hast prevailed.
Good. And I think you started the comment, so I come yeah. back to you. I come back to you, Sister Carol.
Okay,
so you can do some more with that comment on
yes.
that particular name change as well.
Okay. And just in quick said, we know, many of us, we know the story about Jacob, of mm-hmm. how he tricked his father to get the blessing and the birthright that belongs to his brother. So he was a trickster. So here God is saying he's going, what he's going to do through Jacob. But in order for God to do anything to Jacob, God said, listen to me, I'm going to change your name. And the name that God has changed, as we see, Israel. So no, he's no more a trickster. He's a person that God can use. And even in saying to we too, as people of God, God has changed our names. And as I said, there's a new name written in heaven, and we are Christians. And be Christians, we need to follow what God has asked us
right.
to do.
And as you refer to the name change with from Jacob to Israel, the passage you read also, Pastor, indicated a reason.
Of course.
A meaning behind that change,
yeah.
which you explained in mm-hmm. one way, but notice the actual reading of the verse.
Mm-hmm.
What was God saying to Jacob at the time?
It really was a message of hope.
Yes.
That you have lost the battle
mm-hmm.
by disobeying.
Mm-hmm.
But now you have gained victory, not over your problems, but over your nature,
mm-hmm.
your character as a deceiver. You're now an obedient one. You're now the victorious one because of this name change. So God, in the changing of the name, God is not so much interested only to change the name.
That's right.
But the character.
Yeah. That's right.
So that we can become what he really wants us to be.
And you talk about the victory that, you know, Jacob would have got by that name change as mm-hmm. God pronounced it then.
Yes.
I see also before us a similar thing with the name change with Abram,
yes,
to Abraham, mm-hmm, because God wanted Abraham or Abram to get that victory, knowing that stop doubting,
oh, yes,
Abraham, stop doubting.
That's right.
I promised you, and I'm going to do it for you.
Yes, yes.
Abraham, what it means is that it is going to happen. You're, yes, going to be a father of many nations.
That's right.
And you know, these two examples are great examples for us, where God actually, you know, manage the whole process of the name change.
He does.
There are other examples in the Bible where names were changed, mm-hmm, not by God, but, yeah, in other situations, but they were changed for specific reasons as well.
That's right. That's right.
And the lesson makes mention of Joseph.
Yeah.
And, mm-hmm, Daniel, mm-hmm, and his three friends. Mm-hmm. Those names were changed for special reasons,
yeah,
as well.
Of course, not
and
a
we,
positive,
yes,
reason. Negative.
Yes, but whatever it is that they wanted to carry out,
yes,
it goes, mm-hmm, back to the point we were making earlier on,
that
names are important. Names have meaning.
Yes.
And sometimes it's not the name that you have on your birth certificate,
mm-hmm,
but,
mm-hmm,
sometimes we call people some names.
Yeah, alias names. Alias names.
And we must be very careful.
That's true.
Because I remember it was long, long time ago, because if you can imagine, when I went to primary school, what time they were called elementary school, and I remember there were two little boys at school. Their mother was a teacher. And I remember distinctly what was said, that, you see, those two boys, mark you, they were very mischievous boys. But then she referred to them that one of them is Satan and one is the devil. No, when you attach those kind of a names to your children, what are you expecting,
yeah,
of them?
Wow,
be careful yeah, what we call our children. Be,
oh,
careful what we call others,
yes,
because names carry meaning. And as we think about that and we move from that section of the lesson to the next section of the lesson, we are going to be looking at covenant stages. We discuss the covenant in different settings at different times.
Yes.
And it seems that every time we say something special about the covenant, we are seeking to understand a little bit more about what is involved in a covenant, and in particular in God's everlasting covenant. So as we look at Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 to 3, we will learn something more about covenant stages.
And it says here, "Now the Lord had said unto Abram, get thee out of thy country, and from thy kindred, and from thy father's house, unto a land I will show thee, and I will make of thee a great nation, and I will bless thee, and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing, and I will bless them that bless thee, and curse him that curseth thee. And in thee shall all the families of the earth be blessed."
Yes. The lesson requires us to read more. We are even referred to Genesis chapter 15, verses 7 to 18. That's a long reading, and it would do us well to see what is involved there. But from this little section that we have just read, chapter 12, verses 1 to 3, can we see these three stages coming through? How do we link these stages with what we just read there a while ago?
Well, the stages are not completed in chapter 12, but we can see the beginning of the stage. For first of all, God approached mm-hmm, Abram.
Good.
While he was in Ur of the Chaldees.
Mm-hmm.
And he called him.
Yes.
To get out of there and to go to a land that he had promised.
Mm-hmm.
And so God is the one who initiated the stages of the covenant. He was the one who proposed the covenant, and not Abraham. He's the one who stipulated the promises and all that is required in the whole covenant relationship. Mm-hmm. So God started the covenant by calling Abraham to get out of his homeland to go to another place. But we see where the covenant takes on the other stages.
Yes.
As you go to chapter 15, and you go to chapter 17, you see where it is developing in stages, so that God is not just making one statement and it ends. But as Abraham lives, as he goes through his experiences, he comes back again, and he reminds him, and he adds more to the covenant. He keeps adding more to the covenant by making it clear so that Abraham can understand the love that God has for him.
Right. So the three stages we are talking about here are, one, the approach of God to man.
That's right.
Good. We see that happening there. Number two, the call to human obedience.
Right.
We might not see that coming out so clearly there, but we can also understand that it was important that God approached Abraham because of Abraham's tendency to obey God.
Yes.
And even in that little passage, we also see some of the promises being made, is the third stage, the divine promise. And we see that coming out in different times. And as you rightly said, Pastor, that, you know, it's almost as if more promises are added. In some cases, when you look carefully, it's not more, but it's the promise stated in a different kind of way, so that it will become more pronounced and more meaningful.
That's right. We notice also that in chapter 15, one of the stages mentioned is God telling Abraham, or Abram, what he should do to get the covenant, as it were, in a meaningful way understood.
Yes.
He says, take the animals, just like they would do a covenant in the ancient time. Take these animals, cut the bullock into, cut the other animal into, the ram, but the birds don't cut them into. Because in ancient times, when two persons were making a covenant, they would actually cut the animals into on the altar, and they both would walk through the pieces, which signified that anyone failing to obey the stipulations would be cut into just like the animals.
All right.
But Abraham actually fell asleep, and God himself walked through to show that he's willing to commit himself.
He's not going to fail.
Okay. And as we even look at it with the everlasting covenant, we realize that, this was a covenant that God has made, and the stages here with Abraham. And we see it even come down to us too, because it's an everlasting covenant, which we too, God is doing the same thing on our behalf as well. To say, listen to me, this is my approach. I'm taking this up. I'm coming to you. Yes, it's for you to be obedient. And even with all these stages, God is still very much, you know, involved in every stage. He did not leave up to to say, okay, I'm making it with you, so you need to make out your own way. No, he said, no, I'm involved with you. I'm here, I tell you what to do. You, man, you need to be obedient. You cannot be obedient by yourself. I have to give you the energy, the grace to do so, and the promise, even for us to accept the promise.
Yes.
God has to give us that will and the power to even accept the promise. And that's why even in the New Testament, we can see that for us, by faith, if we accept the promise, even through the Messiah, we will be blessed. That's why it says an everlasting covenant for us too.
Thank you so very much. And having gone through all of that explanation and looking at what is there for us in this lesson on an everlasting covenant, we are going to be looking at this closing section of our study for this week, which has to do with covenant obligations. We have met this before, but we are going to be looking at something very special here as we read Genesis chapter 18, verse 19.
For I know him that he will command his children and his household after him, and they shall keep the way of the Lord to do justice and judgment, that the Lord may bring upon Abraham that which he hath spoken of him.
Yes. For I know him. And from our reading there, we realize that this is a pronouncement of God himself.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And he's talking about his servant Abraham. Mm-hmm. It's interesting that as God is making this pronouncement, he is building into this the importance of man's part in the covenant that he, God, has established with man.
That's correct.
What sort of a character are we seeing here in the man Abraham?
We're seeing a character of true obedience. This is a man who, from the very beginning of the call,
mm-hmm.
he just followed what God says.
Yes.
God said, get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred and from thy father's house unto a land that I will show thee. And God says, I'm going to make you a great nation. I'm going to bless you. And the Bible says in Genesis 12, verse 4, so Abram departed.
Yeah.
He just followed exactly what God said to get out, and he left. In chapter 15, God told him, I'm going to fulfill my promises, and the Bible says that Abraham believed God.
Yeah. But Pastor, you see all that first part that you just explained a while ago about God telling Abraham to get up and leave his home and go to a place where he will show him. You need me tell me no. I will show you. Go to this. The Bible makes it look as if, well, it was an overnight thing. But do you believe it was an overnight thing?
It must have been a struggle for Abraham, first of all, when he got the call.
Yes.
But he decided in his mind that if God said this to me, I'm going to do it.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to obey him. And mm-hmm. he did.
Mm-hmm.
For us today, it is not easy either when God says to do this or to go there. It takes faith.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why we see Abraham as the father of faith.
Yes.
He was a faithful man. And now in chapter 18, God is putting on his approbation.
Yeah.
His affirmation of the character of the man.
Mm-hmm.
I know him, that he will command his household after him to do what I say. And that is important, because without true obedience to the stipulations of the covenant, there can't be any reward. There can't be any blessing. And mm-hmm. so that is something great that we see in Abraham.
Yes.
Okay, when we look at it here, as we have been saying, is that God actually initiate the call or the offer.
Mm-hmm.
And we know that man of our Abraham of his own self could not just move, but God gave him that energy, gave him that spirit. And even for Abraham just to move, we realize that for him to just obey, it did not come overnight. And even for us too today, God is depending on us. And what are some of the things that you might be asking? How can I reach that level where Abraham was? How can God say, I know you. I know you'll command your children, your household after me. We have to spend time worship with God, devotion, which is important,
mm-hmm.
by reading our Bibles, praying in the morning, in the evening. When we do these things, we are going on constantly. We are just building our relationship with the Lord. The more we build our relationship with the Lord, is as the song says, Read your Bibles, pray every day, and you will grow. But the moment we neglect, we are going to shrink. So we find that Abraham was constantly in communion with God. Mm-hmm. So I want to encourage those who are listening, even with the children, it has to be a practice. It's not going to be easy. At times, the children are not going to want to come to worship, but our devotion, you have to do what you have to do to make sure that they are there, because you are training them to love God. And Abraham, God could say, I know him. Mm-hmm. And God wants to say that to us. Can you imagine? God is looking and I said, you know, Carol, I know Carol is not going to do that. What a pronouncement. I know Pastor Sonny not going to do it. I know Sister Stevenson. And that God wants us to be in that position. And it doesn't come overnight. Mm-hmm. Every day we have to. So today we are there. Tomorrow we have to do what we have to do to stay there.
Yes. And whether we want to believe it or not, whether we want to accept it or not, God knows us.
Yes.
Oh, yes. So, you know, maybe the more important part of this statement or this declaration is the part which follows. Mm-hmm. I know him.
Yeah.
I know her. That he or she will command his household, her household. He or she will do what is to be done to draw men unto me, God is saying. And that is what God expects of us. Can I have your final little statement on this lesson, Pastor?
I believe that if anything that we can ever do is to really believe what God says, and be willing to make a commitment so that his promises can be fulfilled.
Amen.
Amen. And when I look at it, and if by studying the lesson, I realize, as you said, everlasting covenant. We have seen that God even told Noah that, listen, I'm going to destroy this earth. And yes, God did destroy the earth with water. And he had put a rainbow in the sky as a promise. He said, listen to me, I will not destroy it again with water. And many times we go out there, we can see the rainbow when, you know, it's going to rain, as a promise to say God is a promise keeper. So even with this as well, is an assurance for us to know that, listen, we can stay on the side of God because he's going to keep his promise, and we just need to keep ours.
With all of what has been said, let's see if we can just put all of that in the same light as this statement, which is written here, which says, covenant breaking through disobedience is unfaithfulness to an established relationship. When the covenant is broken, what is broken is not the condition of bestowal, but the condition of fulfillment. God is ever ready to bestow on us that which he has promised, that which he has established. If we want this to be fulfilled in our lives, then he calls us to a life of obedience to his will. God bless you as you have studied with us this week. And we invite you to join us next week as we continue our Bible study hour. We want you to rely on God. We want you to take God at his word, because God wants to do nothing else but to save us all. So be blessed. And remember, look to God during this week that is ahead of you, because it is in God that we have hope in this life and hope for all times. As we close off our study for this week, we just want to pause again to say thanks to our sponsors, Easy Deal Auto Sales and Towards Limited, located at 1139 Catherine Hall, Montego Bay. We say thanks to all those who have made it possible for us to go through this study. And we are saying thanks to God for making it possible for us to take part in it. And we ask you now to join us in our closing prayer.
Father, which art in heaven, thank you again for loving us and dying for us. Thank you for the everlasting covenant that you have made. And help us so that we will just embrace the covenant to live for you, to do what you want us to do. Bless those who are watching. Bring them closer to you as well. And when time and earth shall be no more, help us all to have a place in your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.